said in a recent interview, Murrow was a complicated man who had incredible power in those days. But it began to go downhill after the highest moment in his career, his March 9, 1954 attack on Senator Joseph McCarthy.
There is a danger that the individual comes to believe that just because his voice is amplified and reaches halfway around the world, that he is therefore more intelligent, more discerning than he was when his voice only reached from one end of the bar to the other.
American Masters is made possible by a major grant from the National Endowment for the Arts and the financial support of viewers like you, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, the Marilyn M. Simpson Charitable Trust, the Marjorie Carr Adams Charitable Trust, and Rosalind P. Walter.
We shall make an effort to be as objective as we can. At the same time, we are fully conscious that there is no such thing as a wholly objective reporter. We are all the prisoners of our own experience, of our reading, of our indoctrination, and our travel. We will undertake to give you as fully and impartially as we can the news from week to week.
From the rooftops of London during the Blitz, to the floodwaters of the Missouri River, to the war in Korea, Edward R. Murrow set the standard for courageous reporting. William Paley called him the conscience of CBS. But as the country entered the McCarthy era, Murrow's conscience would get him into trouble, and his courage would be tested.
Informers took their Judas pay to tell their sorry tale. The gangs in Congress had their way, and three souls went to jail.
Wasn't that a time? Wasn't that a time? A time to try. The soul of man, was a bad, a terrible time.
There's a moment in the early 50s when Murrow is at the height of his game. He is the single greatest voice in broadcasting. And at the same time, you're getting into all kinds of domestic controversy. And suddenly, there's not one great consensus view. It's a bitterly divided country. It's divided over the issue of McCarthyism.
I spent about half an hour with the general last night. While I can't report that we agreed entirely on everything. I can report that when I left that meeting with the general, I had the same feeling as when I went in, and that is that he's a great American, will make a great president.
We were terrified by a demagogue and demagoguery that held this country in thrall, and nobody knew their way out.
A few days ago, I read that President Eisenhower expressed the hope that by election time in 1954, the subject of communism would be a dead and forgotten issue. The raw, harsh, unpleasant fact is that communism is an issue and will be an issue in 1954.
Even with a Joe McCarthy, Murrow was a smart enough journalist and Fred Friendly a smart enough producer to know that you have to wait for the right moment.
He had made up his mind along the way that someday he would have to have a direct confrontation with McCarthy.
If they had gone after McCarthy in 1953 rather than 1954, they might have been destroyed and McCarthy might have come out a bit bigger and stronger than ever.
I did not know that a McCarthy show had been specifically scheduled until, apparently, after Friendly and Murrow had met with Mr. Paley in his office and had discussed the program. He had asked Friendly and Murrow whether they had consulted with me about the program. And they said, no, they hadn't, but they would immediately. You know, I had no way of exercising any control of it.
No one was going to tell him and us what to put on the air. That was our decision. We had autonomy. That was the deal we had at the beginning.
My memory of that night when Murrow said, we're going with this broadcast, it was a very desperate night.
We held a meeting in the screening room, and they told us, Ed and Fred both said, we're going to go up against McCarthy, and what we have to be sure is that we do not have an Achilles heel here anywhere as a way for McCarthy to get back at us.
I said, you know, if this program goes on the air tomorrow night, we have this big ad. Program will have a lot of impact. The one that McCarthy and his friends will go after is none of us, but Murrow. But any weakness in any of our characters or our history would be used against it.
Therefore, if any of you know of anything or any reason why you might be that vulnerable spot, you know, speak now or forever hold your peace.
And one person said that his wife had once been a member of the Young Communist League.
I'd been married to a lady who held a communist card, but we'd been divorced and we disagreed politically anyway, but I didn't want to be the Achilles heel.
Ed laughed, sort of somberly. And then he looked down, he had his hands on his knees on a couch like this, cigarette dangling from his lips. He looked up and he said, the terror is right here in this room. We go tomorrow night.
CBS Television, in cooperation with its affiliated television stations, presents the distinguished reporter and news analyst, Edward R. Murrow.
Good evening. Tonight, See It Now devotes its entire half hour to a report on Senator Joseph R. McCarthy, told mainly in his own words and pictures.
Apparently, the president and I now agree on the necessity of getting rid of communists. We apparently disagree only on how we should handle those who protect communists.
No one familiar with the history of his country can deny that congressional committees are useful. It is necessary to investigate before legislating. But the line between investigating and persecuting is a very fine one, and the junior senator from Wisconsin has stepped over it repeatedly.
May we come to order? Mr. Reed Harris. Your name is Reed Harris?
That's correct. Often operating as a one-man committee, he has traveled far, interviewed many, terrorized some. Accused civilian and military leaders of a great conspiracy to turn over the country to communism.
The question is, did the Civil Liberties Union supply you with an attorney?
They did supply an attorney.
The answer is yes?
The answer is yes.
You know, the Civil Liberties Union has been listed as a front for and doing the work of the Communist Party.
Mr. Chairman, this was 1932.
Right. Yeah, I know that's 1932. Do you know that they since have been listed as a front for and doing the work of the Communist Party?
I resent the tone of this inquiry very much, Mr. Chairman. I resent it not only because it is my neck, my public neck, that you are very skillfully trying to wring, but I say it because there are thousands of able and loyal employees in the federal government of the United States who have been properly cleared according to the laws and the security practices of their agencies, as I was.
We must not confuse dissent with disloyalty. We must remember always that accusation is not proof, and that conviction depends upon evidence and due process of law. This is no time for men who oppose Senator McCarthy's methods to keep silent, or for those who approve. We can deny our heritage and our history, but we cannot escape responsibility for the result. There is no way for a citizen of a republic to abdicate his responsibilities. As a nation, we have come into our full inheritance at a tender age. We proclaim ourselves, as indeed we are, the defenders of freedom wherever it continues to exist in the world. But we cannot defend freedom abroad by deserting it at home. The actions of the junior senator from Wisconsin have caused alarm and dismay amongst our allies abroad and given considerable comfort to our enemies. And whose fault is that? Not really his. He didn't create this situation of fear. He merely exploited it, and rather successfully. Cassius was right. The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves. Good night, and good luck.
That night, television came of age. Television was now a real force to be reckoned with in the world.
I think that was his high point of influence in American broadcasting. I think from there on in, it went down. It became controversial. During that period prior to the McCarthy show, there was beginning to be a feeling that this could be dangerous. And that's, and McCarthy simply confirmed the whole thing.
Murrow was afraid, you know. He was frightened a lot of the time. But he was smart enough, wise enough to recognize that one must take the fear, take the fright, and go on anyway.
Fear is a great contagion, but courage can be an even greater contagion.
After the McCarthy show, Ed did receive a great many threats, not only to himself, but to Casey. And Ed said to me, we mustn't let Casey ever be alone.
They were absolutely remarkable in keeping that away from me. I certainly remember kids whom I knew announcing to me that my father was a communist or my father was done something wrong. Often I wasn't quite clear what they were talking about.
When the record is finally written, as it will be one day, it will answer the question, who has helped the communist cause and who has served his country better, Senator McCarthy or I? I would like to be remembered, if at all, by the answer to that question.
Bill Paley began to become nervous about it prior to the McCarthy show. And my guess is that he was under a considerable amount of pressure after the McCarthy show to do something about it.
Paley did suggest tomorrow that we offer McCarthy a half hour of air time to reply, which we had already considered doing had it written into the script.
If the senator believes we have done violence to his words or pictures, if he desires to speak, to answer himself, an opportunity will be afforded him on this program.
Now, ordinarily, I would not take time out from the important work at hand to answer Murrow. However, in this case, I feel justified in doing so because Murrow is a symbol, the leader, and the cleverest of the jackal pack, which is always found at the throat of anyone who dares to expose individual communists and traitors.
Senator McCarthy proved again that anyone who exposes him, anyone who does not share his hysterical disregard for decency and human dignity and the rights guaranteed by the Constitution, must be either a communist or a fellow traveler. I fully expected this treatment.
Mr. Murrow said on this program, and I quote, he said, the actions of the junior senator from Wisconsin have given considerable comfort to the enemy. That is the language of our statute of treason, rather strong language. If I am giving comfort to our enemies, I ought not to be in the Senate. If, on the other hand, Mr. Murrow is giving comfort to our enemy, he ought not to be brought into the home of millions of Americans by the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Senator McCarthy mentioned that if he were wrong, he should be out of the Senate. And if you were wrong, you should be off television. Would you comment on that to Ms. Murrow?
Well, I should think the Senate would decide on the first question, and I would think that the Columbia Broadcasting System would decide on the second.
8 months later, the Senate did decide. On December 1st, 1954, it voted to censure Joe McCarthy.
After the McCarthy show, our contract with our sponsor, Alcoa, was coming up for renewal. And coincidentally, Alcoa did not renew.
They canceled not because of the McCarthy episode. They canceled because they were looking for a program that would attract more people, move more goods off the shelves than the one we had been doing. I accept their explanation in this case. And as I say, the answer will come in terms of whether anyone else decides to sponsor it.
And you think they will, of course.
I have no alternative but to say they will. But whether they do or not, and this again is an aspect of commercial television. In this particular case, whether it is sponsored or not, it will remain on the air.
the day of the show, Bill Paley called and said, I'm with you today, I was with you yesterday, and I'll be with you tomorrow. In fact, it was the end. And from then on, there was a systematic attempt at CBS from Paley, using Frank Stanton as an instrument of this policy, to make sure that nothing like this ever happened again that could put, in their words, the network at risk, based upon the power of an individual journalist uncontrolled by the bureaucracy and apparatus of CBS.
The company began to become nervous about doing anything in television which would upset the Congress, upset the advertisers, upset the FCC.
Controversy translated into a loss of business, and that made them uncomfortable.
And as a consequence, it became, I guess, probably more conservative in the sense that it wanted its programs to be a little less controversial than the See It Now programs were.
People sided with Ed because they liked the fine man who was on Person to Person entertaining them all week.
Good evening, Mrs. Roosevelt.
Good evening, Mr. Morrow.
Are you there, Senator?
Yes, right here, Mr. Morrow.
Good evening, sir.
Remember when Ed Morrow took a camera into somebody's house or apartment? That was as fascinating as the person he was interviewing. In Person to Person, you had a camera in someone's house? Wow.
And now we're in the house.
Because he was Ed Morrow, he was able to attract everybody and anybody, and he did.
Ah! Good morning.
Good evening, Miss Bookall. Betty?
Hello, Ed. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Just fine, thanks.
I am nervous when I have to be myself and have an interview, or, you know, but particularly then because it was live and because I hadn't done it very often and I wanted it to be right and I was scared.
That looks like an interesting bracelet you're wearing. Is it special for television visitors or is it just a little thing you picked up somewhere?
A fellow by the name of Mr. Bogart gave this to me. In honor of To Have and Have Not, the first picture in which we appeared in together.
Yes?
And it was sponsored by a line that I said in the picture. I don't know whether you remember it or not, but the line goes something like this. If you want anything, all you have to do is whistle. You know how to whistle, don't you? You just put your lips together and blow. And that's it.
Well, I thought I was going to faint from fear. But it worked out.
When Ed Morrow did Person to Person and took us inside those homes and treated the young politician like John Kennedy the same way that he treated Sophie Tucker, for example, and made us see that they were people, that was innovative. That was something we didn't have.
You do much entertaining, Sophie Tucker?
Yes, indeed. Eddie, whenever I get home, the first thing I do is entertain the people that have been kind and sweet enough to entertain me when I was on the road and here in the city. And of course, the girls will be thrilled, Eddie. They'll be thrilled when they see my lovely linen closet.
Oh, yes.
All this that I've saved and purchased at Prague and at Budapest and at France, all over the world.
I remember Sophie Tucker opening her closet and showing us her linens. You know how many years that's been? I still remember those linens.
And it's kept so beautifully in my little home. And I'm so proud of my servants who do everything in the world to make me happy.
I think he enjoyed Person to Person more than many people think he did.
He was a little embarrassed by it.
Ed and I met in Paris. He was coming back from Algeria. I was coming back from the Grace Kelly wedding, and we found out we were both on the same BOAC Strata cruiser flying home. We sat together, and after his second or third scotch, he turned to me, as only Murrow could and would, and said, what the hell were you doing wasting your time at Grace Kelly's wedding? And I said,
the same thing you were doing, looking in Marilyn Monroe's closet on Person to Person. And he said, kid, you got me.
Well, now, your picture has been on the cover of almost all popular magazines, hasn't it?
No, not the Ladies' Home Journal.
That you would like, would you?
Yes.
Why?
Well, I used to long for it. I used to appear on, when I was modeling, on men's magazine covers, mm-hmm. such as, I don't know, Squint, Peep, Take a Peep, all those women.
But not the Ladies' Home Journal.
No.
Ed was theatrical, and I'm not sure he wanted to be or tried to be. He just was. There was no way he couldn't be theatrical.
I told him, I said, you're a great star. He was furious. He said, I'm not a star. Don't ever call me that. I said, don't be ridiculous. Of course you're a star. I said, you're a great journalist, but you happen to be a star. Otherwise, people wouldn't be watching your program. He hated that. He was never at ease with that vision of himself. And he didn't have that vision of himself.
Bravo.
It was a very successful program, and people, I still meet people on airplanes, and they say, oh, I love the work that you and Mr. Murrow did, especially that Person to Person.
I remember vividly one afternoon, it was about 5 o'clock, we came in, we were waiting at National Airport to get a cab, and this man came up to Ed, and he said, I admire your program so much. I never miss your program. And Murrow's face just brightened in a wonderful way. It was just like a morning sunrise. And the man said, oh, I, my wife and I would never miss Person to Person. And it was just as though a shade had been pulled down over his face. It just went dark.
See It Now was the program Ed Murrow loved. Even though he'd lost his position in primetime and had difficulty finding sponsors, Murrow just kept on doing serious subjects, often controversial subjects.
The Union of South Africa has been called a melting pot of the races, in which nothing melts, not even the human heart.
You can certainly destroy enough of humanity so that only the greatest act of faith can persuade you that what's left will be human.
He was always fair. He examined all sides of every issue.
This is a report on a little newspaper and a big scandal.
He told each story using his favorite device, the little picture.
There was a little picture of the Murrow-CBS relationship as it deteriorated that brought it all into focus. In 1956 or 7, we did a program, an hour, on Alaska-Hawaiian statehood.
Speaking of Alaska and Hawaii, Senator George Malone, Republican of Nevada, said, they have no direct knowledge of life in the United States and are different from us. Its population is roughly 200,000, of whom 50,000 are military. But as with other territories which became states, it is the homesteaders, rather than the military or the transient workers, who will give Alaska its real strength.
Tell me why you came up here.
They couldn't live the kind of life I wanted to live, so we came to live the type he lives. I'd like to live in the Virgin Islands, New York, Paris. This is a compromise.
Senator Eastland, you're against statehood for Hawaii. Why?
Ed, I'm opposed to statehood for Hawaii because the Communist Party controls the economy of the island. The Communist Party controls the politics of the island.
The senator is the leader of the southern group that is determined to see that Hawaii doesn't get statehood. He doesn't want to come right out and say why, the real reason why, because he's a southern Dixiecrat and he doesn't like people who are not white. He's a white supremacist and he's made a career of it.
Representative Tillian, a Republican of New York who opposes statehood for Hawaii, has said the following. Statehood guarantees Harry Bridges 2 seats in the Senate and 2 in the House. Could you comment about that?
I think he's crazy. Of all the jokes on the people of Hawaii, and that's a laugh.
There has been no great public debate on the matter of bringing these two territories into the Union. Also, the Congress has not appeared to feel any sense of urgency about the matter.
We have presented this report in the hope of starting a small argument about it.
There was a congressman from Buffalo, New York, a rather unimportant congressman in terms of seniority or ranking.
Congressman from Buffalo, Pillion, had objected to the program, was unfair to the people who were against statehood, and demanded equal time.
Murrow and Friendly, of course, didn't see any reason in the world why that should be done.
Pillion took his request for airtime directly to top management, and without consulting Murrow, they granted it. And Ed wrote a letter of resignation. He said, "You've taken a program that we did that was eminently fair, that we worked on, we put the other side on, and you've taken and given a half hour of airtime, I think it was only 15 minutes of airtime, to a congressman from Buffalo who had nothing to do with this issue."
Murrow, at that time, was a program producer and a performer, in a sense, and a news broadcaster. But he was not involved in the policy level, the management level at CBS.
We had a meeting with Mr. Paley. And it was some shouting match.
And, of course, you could be sure how it was going to end.
And at one moment, Ed heard Paley say to him, "Well, you don't want to do it now anymore, I hear. You resign." Ed said, "No, he didn't resign. I just said, under these circumstances, we can't do it."
At some point or other, when Paley was tired of arguing any further, he'd say, "We're going to give the time to the congressman, period."
That's not saying something to Pillion. That's saying something to Ed Murrow. That's saying, "We don't want you anymore. You've lost your freedom."
Ed said to him, "Don't you want us? Don't you want to have an instrument like the See It Now unit to do these programs?" And Bill Paley patted his stomach, and he said, "Yes, but I don't want a pain in my belly every time you do a program." And Ed, striding across the room, both of them in their shirt sleeves, said, "That's the price you have to pay, Bill. It goes with the job." But the job was over.
This just might do nobody any good. At the end of this discourse, a few people may accuse this reporter of fouling his own comfortable nest. And your organization may be accused of having given hospitality to heretical and even dangerous thoughts.
In 1958, I traveled out to Chicago with Ed to the RTNDA National Convention, Radio Television News Directors Convention, without any knowledge whatsoever that the speech was going to be an extraordinary speech.
Our history will be what we make it. And if there are any historians about 50 or 100 years from now, and there should be preserved the kinescopes for 1 week of all three networks, they will there find recorded in black and white, or perhaps in color, evidence of decadence, escapism, and insulation from the realities of the world in which we live.
I think he was distressed by the trivia in television. He didn't want to see the news go that way. To a considerable degree, it has gone that way. The standards have been lowered.
What happens now is we've removed words from journalism. The picture is all that counts. And pictures appeal to emotions. They appeal to intuitive logic, not empirical logic. And so now we have pictures driving the mind of the viewer, not words that put the pictures into context.
It is true. As much as we know in our hearts that it is about the words we say and the content, we are forever thrilled by what a satellite can do. Still, we're the first victims of our own technology.
While on the one hand, the technology makes everything enormously accessible, what it does not do is leave the correspondent a great deal of time to do what, in theory, he ought to be doing, and that is gathering information.
One of the great troubles is the news comes too fast for the explanation of the news. Now, it's like a spotlight in the darkness, the news action. It focuses on what's moving, and everything else is blotted in the darkness.
Murrow always had time to ponder a little and to be sure that he was saying exactly what he wanted to say.
Just once in a while, let us exalt the importance of ideas and information. Would this somehow blemish the corporate image? Would the stockholders rise up and object? I think not.
I think most of us in the industry, in the news side, applauded that statement.
But I think it also served as a kind of a warning to people involved in television, don't let this happen, this thing I'm warning you against.
There is a lovely story that David Schoenbrunn once told me. At the end of World War II, Murrow was talking to him, I guess, one day in 1945, and he looked at him and said, "Hey, kid, what are you going to do after the war?" And Schoenbrunn said, "Well, I guess I'll go back to Brooklyn and teach high school French." And there was a pause, and Murrow said, "Kid, how would you like the biggest classroom in the world?" I'd feel a lot better if the people who own the networks today thought of it as he did, as the biggest classroom in the world instead of the largest cash register in the world.
In the aggregate, there's still, simply by virtue of the number of people out there doing it, there is still as much embarrassing dreck put on the air as we could ever have feared.
Ed would say, as he did in his 58th speech, "We've welched on our promise, and history is going to catch up." And 35 years later, history has caught up.
"That this instrument is good for nothing but to entertain, amuse, and insulate. Then the tube is flickering now, and we will soon see that the whole struggle is lost."
Today, investment bankers run the networks. To them, they own CBS or NBC or ABC as they might own a lumber company, or as they might own a mining company, or as they might own an automobile company. They don't think they owe anything back. Ed thought they owed a lot.
It took a great deal of courage for Uncle Ed to say this to the people that had been his livelihood all these years.
They believed that somebody they had protected, nourished, given the best airtime to, made their crown prince, had turned and attacked them. I think Frank Stanton thought it was an attack on him. I think Bill Paley thought it was an attack on him. It was really an attack on the system. Ed was outraged.
Ed Murrow was many things, and naive was not one of them, but he was oddly naive about what was happening. He thought it was the good Paley and the bad Stanton. I mean, he had this friendship with Bill, who was his pal forever. And suddenly, you know, he can't reach Paley as often. And when he tries to get Paley, he gets Stanton. And he thinks it's Stanton's fault, and he misread it. He didn't know that that which he'd seen happening to 100 other people in 100 other institutions was now happening to him in his institution. And every time Stanton was doing something, it wasn't Stanton doing it. It was Bill Paley.
The Paley-Murrow relationship lasted for a long time, not forever.
I think Ed did definitely want time to think things over, and in order to do that, he took a year off. He was terribly tired, of course, and depressed, and we went to England and were there for almost 3 months.
In 59, I had taken the whole summer off. I was in Spain. I came up to London, where I was going to work, and Ed appeared on his so-called sabbatical with Janet.
On this famous sabbatical, the quiz show scandal happened.
Marilyn Southern, Brooklyn housewife, starts her climb. A climb that may lead to the $64,000 question. Now, the star of our show, Hal Bart.
Doc Stanton made a speech to the radio television news director in New Orleans. He apologized again for the quiz scandals and said, "And from now on, everything we put on CBS air, we will be responsible. There will be no cheating, no faking."
And that was that great statement, "Everything must be what it purports to be.
There is to be no preparation in advance."
And he was referring to the fact that person to person was rehearsed and that the viewer never was told that.
Murrow was angry, about as angry, I guess, as he ever gets. So he fired off a cablegram to me.
I was sitting in the bureau one day, and he walked over to my desk, and he threw down a telegram. Oh, boy. I said, well, you can't send this. And he said, I already have.
Stanton was furious and insisted we had to do something about it immediately. And it became a major event around CBS corporate structure.
That was kind of the beginning of the end for Ed. It was a sign, I now think, of his exhaustion and the kind of depression he was in. He got no rest on his sabbatical. Every day or two or three times a day, there'd be Fred Friendly on the phone from New York about this and that. And he got no rest, but he didn't know how to rest. By that time, he couldn't rest. Didn't sleep well, smoked too much. Got sick again. He was very subject to pulmonary illnesses. Until finally the cigarettes killed him.
He was tired. He'd been doing this kind of thing for 20 years. And it is one thing, if you're a journalist, to fight the people your journalist is supposed to fight. I mean, the forces of darkness to take on either the isolationists or the spokesman for the Third Reich or whatever it is, or Joseph McCarthy. It is another thing when you have to take on your own people. And when you take on your own people, very quickly you lose the taste for the fight.
When Murrow came back from sabbatical, and we were doing CBS reports, we expected him to take over again, to be the Murrow-friendly unit, the way we always had been. But he didn't. He became just another correspondent. And it was sad, because he had lost a lot of his power.
CBS had been the king of the hill. I mean, nobody touched us. No how, no way. And all of a sudden, these two guys, like two gunslingers out of the West, came along, named Huntley and Brinkley.
David, now you have some remarks to make, and come in with your observations, if you will.
Well, we're off to a flying start in many ways, Chet. I was a little staggered to see this convention start on time, and so were the delegates, because they weren't here. I have one quick statistic which I think should go in the record book. It was 12:31:15 Chicago time when we first heard the words, "Will the delegates please take their seats?" And it was 12:32:15 Chicago time when we found that, as always, they did not.
People tend to take politicians, in my judgment, far too seriously. And I don't. I still don't. I didn't then. I don't now. Huntley, not knowing them very well, was somewhat serious about them and spoke of them in, as if he were discussing the Lincoln Memorial or the Jefferson Monument or something like that. And I talked about them as if they were ordinary human beings who happened to be in Congress and lucky to be there. And sometimes I wondered why they were there.
The sardonic wry wit of Brinkley's was a great refresher to my teletype-like delivery.
And I went to Mickelson and I said, Sig was then president of CBS News, I said, we've got one chance. Let's use Murrow with Cronkite to anchor this convention coverage. It was maybe the worst idea anybody ever had.
Another paper is brushing off both of them as chromium-plated organization men, both Kennedy and Nixon.
You know, Walter, it seems to me one of the most important stories coming out of England in the course of the 4 or 5 days that we have been incarcerated here is the one that they have asked, in effect, to renegotiate or at least rediscuss the whole matter of American bases in Britain.
Right.
Which could be a very serious development.
It didn't work out very well. Ed was particularly uncomfortable with it.
Cronkite resented his being there. Murrow didn't want to be there. He didn't really know much about this stuff. Didn't know anything about American politics.
I have a very vivid picture of Murrow at the conventions being humbled to go down on the floor reporting just like any correspondent without any position. He didn't let anyone around know that he was humiliated.
Near the end of his career in commercial broadcasting, anyone who reads the history of Ed Murrow knows he was in many ways betrayed by people both inside and outside CBS News who feared him.
He was squeezed out. He was squeezed out. He was too dangerous. The stockholders loved Murrow, but they wanted more profits.
He wouldn't just take the money and settle for mediocrity. No, That's powerful. And indeed, if you don't subscribe to that, it is something to be feared.
Then there was the night that, for the first time, he couldn't go on the air. It was the radio program. He went to Studio 9, and George Brian was the announcer. And it was only about 30 seconds to air. And he suddenly came out of Studio 9. Blair Clark was working just across the corridor. And he said, "Blair, go on for me." And he handed the script to Blair. I wanted to see how Murrow was. And he went down the hall toward his office. But before he got to his office, there was a stack of filing cabinets, several filing cabinets, and his head was bowed on the top of the filing cabinet, and he was sobbing like a child. It was the first time he hadn't kept an assignment.
And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country.
President Kennedy offered Murrow the directorship of the United States Information Agency, and Murrow, knowing that his days at CBS were coming to an end, accepted. Ed Murrow's 22-year career as a broadcaster was over. He had lost what he loved most.
Suddenly, we had a farewell party. And we said, "But Ed, how can you leave us?" And he said, "I am going to the USIA. And I'm going to do my part for my country." It was a feeling in me that Murrow was going off alone. He always had us with him, not only the editors, but he had the whole, the cameramen, the reporters. He had a whole family around him, family who would support him, and he supported us in turn.
I would think it's fair and honest to say that some part of my heart will stay with CBS. I am grateful to the management of CBS for releasing me, grateful to the affiliates who have carried what we have done, although not always approving, grateful particularly for the friendship of my colleagues and superiors, and CBS Report's viewing audience is now about to be increased by one, and I wish you all good luck and good night.
I'm sure he did miss broadcasting in some ways, and he took a few opportunities to do a couple of programs for USIA, but obviously that wasn't his role. And I'm sure that in some ways he thought he would get back to it, that would be an interlude, and that there would be opportunities to be a broadcaster again in some fashion or other. Of course, that didn't come to pass.
The last time I saw Murrow, when we got into a conversation, he said, "What are you going to do when you leave the White House?" And I said, "Well, I either want to go run a newspaper or I want to go into your business, broadcasting." He sort of smiled, that wry smile of his, and he says, "Well, I hope you come to broadcasting." He said, "But just keep in mind, sooner or later they'll get you." What he meant by that was that in time, if you wanted to be serious in this business, your tether was short, that the clowns and the ringmasters and the barkers, the carnival, would take over totally, and the journalists would be in jeopardy. I think he felt that very keenly toward the end of his life.
Ed always used to say that when he had driven as far as Brewster, he could breathe again. He really felt relaxed. He loved coming to Pauling.
He used this place as a very private spot, and therefore it was very much a family spot.
My wife and I went out to see him at Pauling, really in the period just before he died. And I could tell that he was on the way out. And he tried to show, there was a macho quality about him all the time, that he could still run his own life. And he insisted that he drive us around in this Jeep-type vehicle all around the estate. I remember that he said of his house, it's all paid for, all bought and paid for, because he didn't want to leave his wife with any debts. And it was bouncing, and, you know, he had a gasp of breath, and I said, Ed, I don't think you should be doing this. It's all right, it's all right. He was, just half of him was there, really. I think they had already removed a lung, and it was sad, it was sad.
Murrow said, kid, how would you like the biggest classroom in the world? I'd feel a lot better if the people who own the networks today thought of it as he did, as the biggest classroom in the world.
Harvest of Shame was one of Murrow's last broadcasts. It epitomized everything he stood for.
Now, Edward R. Murrow.
This is CBS Reports, Harvest of Shame. It has to do with the men, women, and children who harvest the crops in this country of ours, the best-fed nation on earth. These are the forgotten people, the underprotected, the undereducated, the underclothed, the underfed. We present this report of Thanksgiving because, were it not for the labor of the people you are going to meet, you might not starve, but your table would not be laden with the luxuries that we have all come to regard as essentials. We should like you to meet some of your fellow citizens who harvest the food for the best-fed nation on earth.
What is an average dinner for the family?
Well, we just... You mean, what do we have in...
Yes.
I cook a pot of beans and fry some potatoes or some corn or something like that.
How many quarts of milk do you buy for the children?
Well, we don't have milk except maybe when we draw our paycheck, we have milk about once a week.
Do they like to drink milk, Mrs. Joseph?
Yes, they like milk.
The only reason I asked that question, I was quite shocked that they had milk only once a week.
Just thought they didn't like it, but they like milk, but it's, well, there's so many, a gallon of milk will make them a glass around, and so we just can't afford it every day.
Jerome, how old are you?
Nine.
Nine? Do you go to school?
Yeah.
Where do you go to school, Jerome?
At the Old Children Elementary School.
I see. Now, Jerome, you are taking care of Kathy, of Beulah, and Lois. Are you going to give them lunch today?
Yeah.
What are you going to feed them?
I don't know.
Do you have any food here to give them?
Yeah.
What time does your mother come home?
I don't know.
Aileen, how old are you?
29.
How many children do you have?
14.
How old were you when you first started working in the fields?
8.
You've been working 21 years in the field?
That's right.
Aileen, do you ever think you'll be able to get out of this kind of work?
No.
The vegetables the migrants picked yesterday moved north swiftly on rails. Produce en route to the tables of America by a trailer is refrigerated and carefully packed to prevent bruising. Cattle carried to market by federal regulation must be watered, fed, and rested for 5 hours every 28 hours. People, men, women, and children, are carried to the fields of the North in journeys as long as 4 days and 3 nights. They often ride 10 hours without stop for food or facilities.
One employer of hundreds of migrant laborers was asked, are they happy people?
Well, I guess they got a little gypsy in their blood. They just like it. A lot of them wouldn't do anything else. A lot of them don't know any different.
The question posed by thoughtful men is, must the 2 to 3 million migrants who help feed their fellow Americans work, travel, and live under conditions that wrong the dignity of man? The migrants have no lobby. Only an enlightened, aroused, and perhaps angered public opinion can do anything about the migrants. The people you have seen have the strength to harvest your fruit and vegetables. They do not have the strength to influence legislation. Maybe we do. Good night and good luck.
What did you think? What was your reaction? What's the reason for the looks on your faces when this film came to an end? What are your immediate reactions? Sean?
Just plain sadness. I mean, these people have to suffer so much so we can benefit with, you know, their work. But they cannot even benefit from the same things that they work so hard for. They pick fruit and vegetables for us to eat, yet they can't even have it themselves. And it's really a shame, really.
Lucy?
Is this going on today? I mean, it was sad because I thought, well, I hope this wasn't going on today because it's really devastating. I know, well, this is only 20, 30 years ago, and I thought things like that didn't happen in America. So.
It made you feel that you should be able to do something, and it reached into you, the person watching it, and I think that's what a good reporter or a good anchor person should be able to do, is to reach into the person watching.
And I think that's why Murrow was so special, because what he did, I'm sure he got a lot of flack for it, you know. I'm sure people gave him a hard time. But I think he stuck with it until he came out with something he was very happy with, and it shows in his work. And I want to do that because of him.
Making subjective judgments about the news can get you in a great deal of trouble. It got Murrow into trouble frequently. The point is, the aim must be elucidation and not advocacy. You're going to stray into that from time to time.
I don't see any way to avoid it. Opinions are subjective. There's no such thing as real objectivity.
None of us are truly objective. Each of us sees things through the lens of our own experience. But it is possible, even though one is subjective, to do justice fairly to your interpretation of those facts, so that it's the reality of the event and not your ideology or your personal prejudice that shape your analysis.
The prejudices are there. They're there in story selection. They're there in what you decide to do in the evening news. And then we go through this process often of trying to sort of wash it all out once it's on the air. There's a kind of cookie-cutter mold that is now expected of people who come into this business, and that's a great shame.
I think Ed had more leeway to preach, if you will. He had a bit of the preacher in him. But more than that, he had a lot of the educator in him.
On television, also in print, journalists, I think, have great opportunity to show the world injustices and really speak for people who normally wouldn't be able to speak for themselves. Instead of reporting what's important, they do the scandalous stuff so they can get a rise out of people and they can get people to watch. I think that those are the wrong reasons to report.
TV news today is, I think, they're mostly into exploitation, digging up dirt about other people, instead of informing us what we really need to know.
For Murrow to open our eyes about something that nobody knew about, that's the real job of a reporter, just inform the world.
Basically, Ed Murrow believed in people, you know, and he believed in this country. He thought there was a lot of goodness here, a lot of capacity to cooperate instructively. He tended to be a pessimist about tomorrow, but an optimist about the day after tomorrow. I don't know that Ed Murrow is a great man in the history book sense, but he was a great person. And he filled a great role in those formative years of this business. You can't duplicate that. We shouldn't even try.
And that's tonight's CBS Evening News. Dan Rather.
That's our report on World News tonight. I'm Peter Jennings.
News for this Monday night. I'm Tom Brokaw.
I'm Bernard Shaw in Washington.
Good night, Jim.
Good night, Robin.
Murrow, by his presence, led. He was as good a reporter as anybody else, but they've been better reporters. He was as good a writer as anybody else, but they have been far better writers.
I'm Ted Koppel in Washington.
I'm Charles Kuralt. I'm Diane Sawyer. Good night, Sam.
Good night, Diane.
He was as adventurous and willing to take on tough subjects. Other people have taken on tough subjects.
Good night, Ted.
Good night, David.
And that's the way it is. Thursday, January 25th.
This is Howard K. Smith. Good night.
This is Eric Everard. Good night.
But the one thing that all these new programs, which touch on everything that we never even dreamed of in the days of See It Now, the one thing they don't have is Edward R. Murrow.
This instrument can teach, it can illuminate, yes, and even it can inspire. But it can do so only to the extent that humans are determined to use it to those ends. Otherwise, it's nothing but wires and lights in a box.
Good night, and good luck.
American Masters is made possible by a major grant from the National Endowment for the Arts and the financial support of viewers like you, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, the Marilyn M. Simpson Charitable Trust, the Marjorie Carr Adams Charitable Trust, and Rosalind P. Walter. This is PBS.